reviewing the Times, and I was jubilant, screaming, calling people up, reading it to them. You know, you were in my first class.
When I did Rodrigo,
I'll never forget it. I remember it as though it were yesterday. The essence of a really good actor is that you stay innocent. Stay innocent, stay curious to the day you die. Don't know the answers. Try to figure out, you know, and try to understand. And you see, that which makes us unique and which allows you to imagine that you live in another time, in another place, in another room, that you really believe that is based on innocence. That's why we act so wonderfully when we're children, because we really believe. And that ability to believe we should keep to the day we die, and don't let anybody take it away from you. Certainly don't take it away from yourself.
Intimidating it is to get up in front of you.
No.
I mean, did you ever get up in front of anybody like you?
Hi.
Hello.
Oh, your hands are cold.
Yours feels warm.
You want to go somewhere? Could walk down by the lake? Or to Overton's Hotel, they're dancing till midnight. Or we could just walk.
I can't. I've got to be back in 10 minutes. I shouldn't even be out here now.
10 minutes? Are you serious? I just came in from Biloxi.
I know, but it's Good Friday.
Isn't that a holiday?
No, it's a holy day. It's the day that Christ our Lord died. We have to abstain from parties or movies or dates. It's a day of prayer and mourning.
Doesn't sound like Good Friday to me. It sounds like Lousy Friday. 10 minutes. Jesus. I'm sorry. No Jesus. I can't believe it.
It's my fault. I should have told you my last letter. We can make up for it next week, can't we?
I'm not sure that I'm going to be here next Friday. We just finished basic training yesterday. We could be shipping out any day now.
Shipping out? To where?
Europe, the Pacific. They haven't told us yet.
Overseas so soon?
They can't keep us here forever. The Army needs reinforcements. We've already lost a sergeant and a private. We're still in Biloxi. Can't you stay out just a little later, just tonight? I know I'm Jewish, but I don't think Christ your Lord's going to hold it against you personally.
I can't. I've got to be faithful to my beliefs, Eugene.
About being faithful to me?
I have been. I haven't been to another USO dance since we met. I just don't feel like dancing with anyone else
anymore.
Cross my heart.
No. You don't have to cross your heart. Religion's always getting in our way. I believe you. Daisy,
What, Eugene?
Well, I want to say something, but I'm having a lot of trouble with my words.
Well, that doesn't sound like Eugene the writer to me.
No, that's because I'm not writing right now. I'm Eugene the talker. I just want to say that, God damn it, I just wish I could say it. I'm sorry. I didn't mean to say that, especially on Good Friday.
I'll say 10 Hail Marys for you.
No, you don't have to say that. They're not going to do me any good.
What is it you wanted to say, Eugene?
Daisy, you know what it is. Just I've never said it to a girl before in my life. I don't know how it's going to sound when it comes out.
Well, say it, and I'll tell you.
I love you, Daisy. That sounded all wrong. That's not how I meant it at all.
I've never heard it said so beautifully.
Wait, what do you mean? How many guys have said it to
you? Oh, none. I meant in the movies, not Tyrone Power or Robert Taylor, even Clark Gable.
Yeah, well, they get paid for saying it. I'm in business for myself.
I remember everything you say to me, Jean. When I go home at night, I write them all down and I read them over whenever I miss you.
Yeah, well, if you're going to keep your your memoirs. Just make sure your locker's closed. I don't want to be the talk of St. Mary's.
It's 8 o'clock. I've got to go.
But you haven't said it to me yet.
That I love you?
No, not like that. You can't just sneak it in all quickly like that. You have to take a breath and prepare for it and then say it.
All right. I've taken a breath. Now I'm preparing for it. And now I'll say it. I love you, Eugene. We can't kiss. It's Good Friday.
You have to kiss after you say I love you. Just not even Godfrey would forgive you that.
All right. I love you, Eugene. Oh, I almost forgot. This is for you. It's a book.
Oh, really? What book? I love your taste in books.
Well, it's blank pages. For your memoirs. Page one can start with tonight. Take care of yourself, Eugene Morris Jerome. And even if some other girl gets you, I'll always know you were my first love.
Okay, I'm working with them.
I completely forgot everything as far as my physical goes, and then found myself...
You see, you can't imagine. You have to rehearse the physical life. You have to open up the seams of it, and if anything, do too much, and then see what you need and what becomes logical and how you go away from and come back to. It's very possible that you might sit right away. I don't know, but you've decided you should stand, do you see? You have 10 minutes. You don't have 30 seconds. You have 10 minutes. Do you follow? Now, I think you haven't followed through on the things you might do. Not feel or think, but do. Do you see? Okay. Now, something interesting you did at the beginning, which again arises in many, many scenes. You come in, he doesn't hear you, and you're surprised. I heard her. Why didn't you?
Actually, I was thinking about the pen. So.
You're not thinking about the pen. You're saying I shouldn't respond to her until she touches my shoulder. And that's a mistake. Now, you know the director who says, you come in, and there he is, and you see him. The director says, no, you don't see him yet. Now, you know you're laughing because that happens all the time, right? So now I come in, and I play, and I don't see you yet. Now I gotta see you. Oh, you know, oh my God. So don't do that to yourself, right? Don't give yourself bad summer stock directions. When you hear her. You're waiting for her. Do you see? You maybe didn't know good that you didn't know she was coming from there. Maybe you hope she's coming from here or from there. But then when you hear her, go with what you hear. Right? Okay. Hear what you hear and see what you see. And go with the responses to that. Okay. If you have a briefcase with you, what's in it? What did you bring it for? What did you bring with you? Did you bring a scratch pad with you to make notes for your next novel? Do you see? Then you will find true occupation. This way it's just a prop. It doesn't serve you. Okay? But the main thing is start with your physical life. And the outdoor scene is always harder than an indoor scene. Did you try it outdoors or not? You did?
It's the only place we did it.
What was around you there?
Mostly field.
Field.
A field.
Trees.
Where was the building? Where was the building?
When we set it? Or
yeah.
When we worked?
No, when you were working outdoors.
Oh, the actual building?
Yeah.
It was off to the left.
Okay. Did you look to see if anybody was coming out of it while you were rehearsing? I bet you did. Mm-hmm. If anybody's watching you while you're making eyes at each other? I don't know. I'm just saying the influence of the surroundings in terms of behavior, not thinking and feeling, but behavior. Give it another crack.
All right.
Very good. Thank you. Yes.
I've read your book in the section on transference several times, and I've really worked on it, but I'm never clear if, I'm doing it, right, you know?
You won't be doing right until you start with your body.
Yeah, okay.
Okay, and where it is and what it's doing there. Then we can start feeling.
Okay.
Okay?
Okay.
It's in the doings that you believe it. Not sitting thinking heat or thinking glare or thinking these things, but what do I do to overcome it? And in the moment of finding the action, you have the sensation. To bring about the things that the scenic designer can't give you. That's the purpose of this exercise. Okay, some of that was wonderful. Now, how did you feel?
I felt private, you know, in my own thing, but the hard thing was trying to fulfill what the exercise is supposed to be and not feeling like this pressure to like, okay, I gotta show this, I gotta show that, I gotta go from this to this, I gotta do all that, I gotta like, you know what I mean?
No, you didn't fall into that trap. I didn't see any of that. I thought it was wonderful. Can you criticize anything? Anything you doubted for a second? I bet you won't, because you did it twice, so I knew that you weren't aware of it the first time. Usually, something like the sand, which is very suggestible, was wonderful right away with the toes while you were lying at the opening. It was just marvelous. Then, after the first brushing yourself off, it had no consequence, and you rubbed sand in your eyes. I thought, oh, his hands, because I was so I was so sensitive to it, and you finally got this off the thing, and then you went, and I thought, ow, he just got sand in his eye.
You're right, and that was a hard thing in working on it, too.
But usually,
I would find myself like, oh, my God, wait a minute.
But it's usually so suggestible that it sets up
that
correct reflexes.
Right,
and the fly was wonderful, the sand fly. And when you shook the shirt out, which was wonderful, I had the feeling it got on your stomach.
Mm-hmm.
And you see, and it wasn't sensorily completed.
Exactly.
If you had allowed yourself more faith in that, it would have followed through all by itself. Okay. This is when I love theater, because that's magic. When I start to see a sand up there and I'm on a beach and I start to feel the sun and get the glare, and it was marvelous, George. Very good. All right. Occupation is what gives us a presence on stage. And it doesn't have to be out or running around and doing the dishes and leaping into bed. What do I do when I seemingly have nothing to do? I'm waiting for a bus, or I'm waiting for a subway, or I'm waiting for somebody in a park. It's the ultimate test, this exercise, and how to put yourself into a time and place and truly be occupied without a whole lot of stuff. Okay. Now, how did you feel?
Pretty good.
It was pretty good. It's amazing for a first one. If anything, if you would criticize anything, what it would be in your selection?
And one technical difficulty is that the rehearse that, but I don't know. You tell me.
You had enough to do so that you're almost avoiding the problem.
Ah, okay, yeah.
Right?
Right.
So you select less activities and see how the interesting thing when this exercise, where you could have gone on another 5 minutes, couldn't you? And it wouldn't have bothered
at
you.
Least, right.
That's what was good about it. And when it's correct, we feel fully occupied if we know where we are, what we're doing there, what we're wearing, where we're going, where we came from. And when I say what we're wearing, how the clothing influences how you stand. If you had on shoes that were too tight, or an evening jacket, or an evening shirt, you would, for going someplace fancy, you would behave quite differently. Isn't that true?
Sure.
And those are the considerations why this is a little bit easier to do here in this exercise than it is on stage, is that when we're on stage in a problem like this, we are wearing a costume instead of our own clothes. We haven't endowed them with a reality so that they belong to us. We very often are spare on inner objects that come from the given circumstances, which are different for the character in the play than they would be for you. And so that it's more difficult to execute on the stage. But the principle of it remains the same. you didn't give yourself enough room in between when you were caught by an inner consideration of something that had happened, something that will happen, what you're going to do when you get there. And you can be caught by an inner object that produces thought where you can be totally still for quite a while.
Right.
And when it wears out for you, then you go to an outer object again. Give yourself more inner objects and more room to deal with them instead of always going from activity to activity. Okay, very good.
Thank you.
Fly away from all these sleepy countenances, these dull faces, this death in life. Great coward that I am. When the man comes here every day, and every day, I know the reason why he comes. I'm stained already. I should fall on my knees and beg Sonia's forgiveness.
Morning.
Good morning.
See my drawings.
Yesterday you said you had some maps you would show me.
I have them.
Are you free?
I am. Where were you born?
Petersburg.
Ah. And what did you study?
At the conservatory.
You may find that this one interests you.
Well, no, why not? I mean, I don't know the country, the topography.
Indeed.
But I have read a great deal.
I have my own work table in this house. Ivan Petrovich's room. When I'm on the point of extreme exhaustion, I forsake my practice and I steal away to spend an hour or two over my maps. Ivan Petrovich and Sofia Alexandrovna are clicking away at the abacus. I'm seated beside them at my work table, painting away. I'm warm. Everything is quiet. I'm at peace. I hear the crickets outside. Totally at peace. All right. Look here. Here's our district, 50 years ago. Dark and light greens indicate the forests. As you see, half of the whole is wooded. Now, where we find green crosshatched with red, we have the range of elks, wild goats, and we show both the flora and the fauna here. Now, on the lake, we have swans, geese, ducks, and as the old folks say, the power of birds. As they would say, as far as the eye could see and farther. A cloud of birds, just flying.
Okay, now, what can you tell me? Lindsay?
I have the hardest time beginning.
You don't know why?
It's
so easy. You see, you're very skillful, so it doesn't show as much, but your problem is identical. Talking to yourself is involuntary. Very often we don't know it. I talk to myself a lot. It took me years to realize it. People walk in and say, who are you talking to? You know. Now, I don't talk to myself when I am physically still. That's why you're having trouble. You see, that's the only reason you're having trouble. You have to have an activity. And you have, and it doesn't have to be completed, and it doesn't have to get all the way finished.
Right.
You see, what you're missing is the vanity. Now, when we have a crush on someone, which you do have on Astrov, big one, we become very self-aware of our bodies, of everything. Now, in what you might choose, I go to the most obvious, I hope you'll reject that, which is to fix your face, or fix your hair, or put a drop of perfume on your kerchief, or I give myself 10 things I could do, and I try them all, always remembering that the purpose is not to finish the activity, but to know what it would be. In any monologue, by the way, I always say, what would I do here if I didn't talk? And I explore all of that, and then at some point it's going to be very easy to start talking.
Right.
Okay? Now, the sensory life, you see, here you stood, he was there, neither of you were physically aware of each other. Right? Did she have on scented soap? You see her hair here? Do you see her hands? She's listening to you. She's looking at the papers. She's going, and you're showing her your work. Now, you see, when you hear him talk, this, you try to listen to this, the tone of his voice, his soap, his leather jacket. I mean, this is so loaded, you see, with sensuality.
See, I know, I thought that what I was trying to do in the scene was to steel myself against that. So
I know, but this is your biggest problem as an actress. You find a mask and you stick to the mask. You forget what's underneath. Never mind these masks. Take them off. And if it's inadequate for the character, I'll tell you. But don't play the cover so successfully. You end up succeeding in the cover. You lose what's cooking, right? No, you can play it, but it is I think that every actor has a huge range of parts which are this big. There's a whole bunch back there he can't play. And I don't mean that there isn't something in the nature of this character that is hard for you. There's no question about it. I was very interested when you were going to work on this scene. I thought, Yelena, how? Then I couldn't wait. So you see. Okay. Now, Brian, how did you feel?
The two biggest issues of this, the primary one being my relationship with Yelena. Secondary, this man that I've come to show. And I have always had this trouble, and I call it spinning, where it's almost like I run up against it and I come back, and I run up against it and I come back, and I run up against it, and I never go through it. I never can find a way of connecting myself to that relationship or to that objective or to that meaning.
And it is terribly hard. I tell you what I think it is. I'm not sure, but I think so. You've made a beautiful map, by the way. I always go crazy with what the actor brings in as a map. The last one I picked up and I said, was that an empty page? And I went and he said, yeah. And you knew that it was an empty page. So that map is crucial. What is missing is that you're not passionate enough about it. This is truly the most meaningful thing in your life, is that pursuit of the ecology, which nobody understands. 100 years ago, Chekhov was concerned with something that is bugging us now. It's fantastic. Now, you see, if you say link it, the opportunity to share that with a person you have got the hots for in no mean terms, right, is so exciting that it's just fantastic.
Where can I go to make that map more important? I'm trying to find issues.
Take something that you really feel passionate about, and now transfer it to that map. Okay? Good. All right. I think that's it. The reason we talk aloud to ourselves is always to gain control over circumstances. And the circumstances can be boredom. I can start playing fancy games with myself because what I'm doing is so tedious. in a big dramatic monologue. It's that you are in crisis and need the words to help yourself find answers. Many, many people say, no, I don't talk to myself. Of course, it's not true. I had an auditor in a class who, while I was teaching this exercise, marched up front, turned to the class and me, and said, nobody talks to themselves unless they're crazy. So I said, please, you're an auditor. That means listen, don't talk, and then go and sit down. So I didn't see this, but I was told afterwards by my key student and people sitting in the back that he was furious. He sat down and for the rest of the class said, I don't know what she's talking about. That's absolutely ridiculous. And talked to the end of the class, but he never talks to himself.
No, I'm living without you. Gotta be free. No, I'm living without you. Oh, thank you, Jesus. Doesn't a Visa card just for cat enthusiasts sound great? Yes. My glasses. Forever losing these stupid things. I know you're here somewhere. I have had it. Where are you? I have had it all. Oh my God, look at this mess. God, my stuff. Oh my God, my statue. I just got this. Oh my God. Oh, they're all broken. Kitties, where are you? I know you're under there. Come here. I had it. All I do is clean up this goddamn mess. Oh, my God. What am I going to do with this Brit? Come here.
Ooh. What is that?
Oh, God. Oh, man. Shit. Oh, for God's sake, now they're puking everywhere. So sick of this. Every time I go somewhere, they clean up and have this junk all over the place. Now I can't have a goddamn piece of plant or anything here. They eat all my goddamn plants. They uproot everything. Look at this. I think I give them enough toys. Jesus Christ. Why don't I just clean this rug? All right, I'm just going to put them all in a cage. I'm going to put you all in a cage when I go somewhere. So sick of this. Is that what you want to do? You want to stay in a fucking cage? I don't give a shit. I just cleaned this goddamn rug. They steal my curlers. All my curlers are gone.
Okay. Now, how did you feel?
It didn't work, the element of discovery of this for me, really.
That was the only note I had was discovering the room.
And I don't know why. Every time I come home, I'm so...
And no. What was missing was, you see, you demanded something when you first saw it. You demanded instantaneous discovery of everything.
Yeah, okay.
And you see, if you see one
right.
thing, and you have to give yourself, every time you do it, the leeway that it's going to move in on you slightly differently. Mm-hmm. Sometimes it may move in on you more quickly. Mm-hmm. Other times you may, in disbelief, I have even, picked things up and said, but you're demanding an immediate horror.
Right. Yes.
And I think that was
the plant, then the picture, and yeah. I did.
Also, you see, even in turning, the expectation of what the room usually looks like.
Yeah.
Not the way it looks now, but the way it's supposed to look. And then it can move in on you. That was my only criticism. I thought all the rest was just wonderful. Again, why do we laugh? We laugh when we recognize ourselves. You see, that's the real communication of laughter, is always in the revelation of, my God, that's what I do. You know? Okay.
The difference is, you're the adult and she's...
I don't believe in that authority crap. I had that up to here.
Well, that's why it's so hard for me.
Oh, I make it hard for you, I suppose.
Well, you make me the bad one.
What happened to this book?
I come out the villain.
This was a new book. Look at it already. Jesus, Hitler didn't do to books what you do.
She calls daddy and you come running. I don't come running and that makes me Hitler? Well, now who's talks in extreme?
Look, a little respect for the printed word, that's all, Louise.
Did you ever make her come to you? Why do you always go to her?
You want me to play power games with a 9-year-old? I want her to know I'm interested in her. Someone around here has to show interest in her.
Oh, you love her more than I do.
No, I didn't say that.
Yes, you did.
You don't know how to listen. You never learned how to listen. It's as if listening to you is a foreign language.
I try to drill some responsibility in her during the day, and then you come home at night and do everything. It's no wonder that she has no respect for me.
I am not going to listen to this. Okay? Want me to have a drink?
At least when you were drinking, you were only mean when you were drunk.
Ow. Okay. I get it. You want me to go back on the booze?
You do exactly what you want. You always have and you always will.
Great. Make you something?
I swear, Jake, if you make yourself a drink, I'll leave you.
What the fuck is going on inside that head of yours? Is that a sane reaction? Huh? If I take a drink, one drink, you'll leave me? I ask you, is that sane? Go fuck yourself.
Fuck you right back!
Go fuck you yourself. Don't you realize you have a child inside? The hell's the matter with you? What's the matter with you, huh? I really think you're crazy sometimes. I'm not gonna take a drink. I didn't even want one.
Okay. When you worked on the material, what was hard for you, the hardest for you? William?
I think most difficult for me was making clear which issue was most vital to me. So I guess I was still working on and trying to figure out what to think about.
Okay. And Cynthia, what was hardest for you?
The hardest thing was trying to find, like, the transitions, because it start when we were doing it, it would, like, be all at one level, and then it would be here, here, and so, like, to find where it kind of, where it went to, and just staying in the moments rather than kind of, like, because it got very general when we were rehearsing it, even though I thought I was being specific in my homework, it was hard bringing it to the scene.
Now, when you read it, what would you classify this play? How would you classify this play? What kind of play is it?
If I had to label it, I would say it was a drama.
And you?
Yeah, a family drama.
See, I think it's a comedy.
It's a comedy.
Now, you see, if it's a drama, it is such an ugly play that I don't know why anybody would want to do it or see it.
Maybe that was the problem.
I think that's the problem. That's what I'm getting at. You see,
I think
you have to find, to make the play tolerable and find variations, because it's, each scene is the same throughout the whole play.
Yeah.
Now, how can you sustain that if it is really that ugly? Now, I'm not a director, and I don't know the play intimately so that I know I'm right, but I think I'm right. So explore it. See what happens. In something like a fight, if two people love each other, a fight can be hilarious. And I got into a fight with my husband that while it was going on, I knew it was ludicrous. It was so funny, but I didn't stop doing what I was doing. You see? Now, what is the fun in fighting, if there is such a thing, is the enjoyment of one-upmanship.
Right.
You see? Now, I think if you look for that, you're going to find so many variations in this. What have you used before as a weapon? When does it work? When does it fail? When are you hit by it? So you need to find another one to top him with or to best him with. Do you follow? The crying. When do you know that the crying is going to undo him? How
right.
good can you do it for him? Do you see?
Right.
See, even the drinking. You know, getting it out, showing it to her. You see, rather than being a true alcoholic who's now going to go back to booze and she gets terrified, it doesn't, if you look at where the next beat goes, it doesn't go there where you're trying to take it. Do you see?
Yeah, that's the problem.
We kept coming up against that.
Yeah.
Where we were taking it, then it didn't really go there.
That's right.
And we didn't really know what else to do.
That's right. And I think if you look for that, you're going to have a field day with it.
Okay?
All right, very good. Thanks.
You.
What's the old line? Comedy is very serious business. Good comedy on a good script, and let's say you've been fortunate and been sent a good script with a good part, it's very seldom that the guy is zany and thinks that he's funny. That's one thing, if you're supposed to think you're funny. But the minute an audience thinks that you think you're funny, you're dead.
I have a wonderful recording. I'm so blessed. Of a Dick Cavett interview with Noel Coward on his 70th birthday and the Lunts. And it's a masterpiece, it really is. And there's one point where they were talking about, the Lunts were talking about how they worked with each other and the problems, and Mr. Lunt said, you know, it was so strange, I kept saying to Linny in this play, the line where I asked for the cup of tea, it's so funny in that circumstance. And I said to her, why can't I get a laugh there? And she said, you don't know? And he said, no. She said, because you're asking for a laugh instead of for a cup of tea. You see?
Why do you always make her come to you?
What's the difference?
The difference is discipline.
Bullshit.
The difference is that you're the adult and she's the child.
I don't believe in that authority crap.
Yeah, well, that's why it's so hard for me.
Oh, I make it hard.
You make me the bad one. I come up the villain.
What happened to this book? Jesus Christ, this was a new book. Look at this already. Hitler didn't do to books what you do.
She calls Daddy and you come running? I don't come running and that makes me Hitler? Oh, well, now who's talking?
No, a little respect for the printed word.
Why don't you ever make her come to see you? Why do you always go to her?
Oh, Jesus, you want me to play power games with a 9-year-old? I want her to know I'm interested in her. Someone around here has to show interest.
Oh, so you love her more than I do.
I didn't say that.
Yes, you did.
You don't know how to listen. You never learned how to listen. It's as if listening to you is a foreign language.
I tried to drill some responsibility in her during the day. You come home at night and then do everything. It's no wonder she has no respect for me.
I am not going to listen to this.
Jesus. I liked you better when you were drinking. You didn't undermine me.
You want me to have a drink, huh?
Well, at least when you were drinking, you were only mean when you were drunk, but now...
Okay, I get it. You want me to go back on the booze.
You know what? You do exactly what you wanted to. You always have, and you always will.
Make you something?
Can I make you something?
If you make yourself a drink, Jake, I'll leave you. What the fuck is going on inside that head of yours, huh? Is that a sane reaction, huh? If I take a drink, one drink, you'll leave me? I ask you, is that sane?
I mean it! Go fuck
yourself! Go fuck yourself! You have a child inside, what's the matter with you? We think you're crazy. Oh, terrific. I'm not going to have a drink. I didn't even want one.
Why you do this to me?
Goddamn thing.
I think we should separate.
No, we are not going to separate.
Well, I can't take this anymore. I just want to die.
You don't want to die. You have responsibilities.
I don't care.
Really want to die? Go ahead and die. Just remember one thing. I can die too. I can die just as fast as you. And I don't have to just threaten it. I'm quite capable of doing it. You want to see me go through that window right now? Huh?
Jake, you know what scares me when you talk like that?
Just so you remember what happens to children of suicides. They often commit suicide too. So you're not just killing yourself. Oh, no. You're also murdering your child. Is that what you want? Hemingway's father committed suicide. This thing is not going to fail, Louise. I want this thing to work. Huh? Don't you want it to work?
Peculiar feeling that working on it the other way in a strange way served you for when you let it go. I'm not recommending that you should start wrong in order to get it right. But in this instance, I really think it had something to do, because it was so full. I have no criticism. I mean, a few little tiny things that are not worth talking about. I just thought it was a field day, a real give and take, and going with it was a delicious.
Can I just follow you around?
No, you learned so much from this. Just wonderful. Okay.
Thank you.
All right. Very, very good. Questions? Yes?
Why do you say to cross out the stage directions?
When I say very emphatically, when you read the play, cross out the stage directions, what I really mean is all adjectives. In other words, happily, gladly, sadly, like a moth. I never could play that opening beat of Streetcar, because it's just like a moth banging against the light bulb, you know, and I had this image of, you know. I thought, oh, God, leave me alone. Eugene O'Neill's descriptions, his novels he writes before you come on, block me tremendously. Yes.
What should you discuss with your scene partner?
Definitely discuss what your objectives are and make sure they're in conflict. Because I can say my objective is to get you out of here, and the other one says my objective is to get out. Well, you got nothing to play. Right? So make sure that they're in conflict. Do not discuss the actions. Don't say, I'm going to do such and such. Then you become an audience. So you say, he's not doing what he just said he was going to do. In other words, and you won't be surprised by them. So never discuss the actions. You can talk about the relationship of what you've done together, previous circumstances, improvise how you deal with each other in a normal day, but don't discuss the psychological life of the scene too much. Get up and do it. There's much too much talk, usually, including gossip, before you start working. Come and work. Start working. Okay, good.
I do so much homework, and then ideally, of course, you forget it all when you get on the in front of the camera or on the stage. You have done all this preparation so that you can be really open. And it's interesting how so many actors out here, especially in film, they don't like to rehearse and they don't like to do homework because they feel like it's going to take away their spontaneity. And it's so interesting because for me, the more rehearsal I do, the more homework I have done, the freer I am, the more spontaneous I can be when the cameras are rolling or when I'm on stage.
I'll tell you a funny story. I played once Streetcar with Marlon Brando without any rehearsal, to standing room only audience, because he was already then totally undisciplined and had taken 2 weeks vacation, and during which I played with Tony Quinn, and then he was supposed to come back from his vacation. We were going to rehearse, and then we were going to play. So he arrived 5 minutes after half hour was called. The producer said, well, what do you want to do? And I said, I don't know. I said to Marlon, you want to try 5 minutes and see what happens? He said, I'm game. And I said, okay. And we rehearsed about 5 minutes, and I thought, oh, I think this might work. He had never seen me. I had never seen him. We really had totally, I had a totally different interpretation than Jessica, and he had a totally different layout than Quinn. It worked like a charm. I wouldn't recommend it. I mean, it was rather unnerving. But, and why it worked was that we had both rehearsed and played a lot in that set with those objects. We never lost circumstances. I'm very attuned to my partner, no matter if I've played with him a long time or a little time, I will be tuned in. And it worked. Now, that can only work if circumstances, relationship, place, every tiny object is familiar to me. Yes?
What do you do when a mistake or an accident happens on stage during a performance?
If a true accident happens, if it is plausible within the circumstances, deal with it. And but if you see if it looked like a mistake, then the actor was saying, oh, I'm sorry, and saying, I got to get over a mistake, rather than saying, oh, my God, I'm sorry, did I do that? Let me get something and mop him up. And nobody will know it was a mistake. They'll think it was in there on purpose. Okay? So what you can't cover is when the scenery falls down. I have another. I also think, you see, if you're playing mechanically or playing posing, any mistake will look terrible. I'll never forget a classical actress who shall remain nameless in a Grecian toga, walking from here to there and walking and she tripped. If she had been walking and she tripped over her dress, it would have been nothing. But because it didn't fit the mold, it looked ludicrous. Okay. Now, the purpose of this exercise, which follows talking to yourself, is to discover all the problems that occur when we have to talk to the audience. I played a lot of plays like that, and it was always unbelievably difficult for me if I left the circumstances in which the play took place. Let's assume it's the Brecht. There are many monologues for the character Shente, whom I played, where she talks to the audience about what she's doing. And if I went from 18th century China to a contemporary audience at the Phoenix Theater where I played it, there were two such totally different realities that I could never recover. So I created for myself imaginary people that were from the little village in China where I lived, who were passersby, who were observing what I'd been doing, so that I didn't lose my character or my time and place by looking at the audience here. Direct eye contact with people who sit in the auditorium. Anybody who tells you you should make eye contact with them is crazy. And I say, to prove the point to yourself, remember the times when you have sat in an audience and a performer has looked right at you. You immediately get very self-conscious. Women always start adjusting their brassiere straps, you know. She's looking at me. What is expected of me? What does she want? Now, that can't help the actor if he sees he's made somebody very uncomfortable. So in order not to make eye contact, I take my imaginary people and place them in the audience, either directly over their heads or in aisles, and I now address them. And everybody here thinks I'm talking to them. You will feel included, more included than if you actually make eye contact. You know, if there's a spill of light here from the stage that makes these eyes visible, and those are just bodies, that's fine. You can look at bodies, but they won't feel attacked, and you won't feel that they interfere with your reality. So now how do I talk to somebody like that? So I've given the actor in this the problem of placing somebody in their own space, imaginarily here, and telling them something to see how this can work.
Oh, boy. I had a great time. The best time is when I'm doing stuff with my nephews and nieces. Like, for the past 3 years, every Christmas Eve day, I get a pad and a pencil, and I write down the names of all my sisters and all their kids and all my friends that have kids. There's so damn many of them, if I don't write them down, I forget them all. So I take a pad, I write down all their names, and I call all their parents, and I ask, you know, what did the kids ask for from Santa Claus this year? And then I write down, I have a list, so this way, I'm in the know. So the day goes on, I usually go to, well, this year I went to an early mass with my folks, Christmas Eve, and we went back at dinner. And then during dessert, when we're having coffee, I grab the list, and I grab the phone, and I start calling up. So this year I called my little niece, Rachel, who lives in Dallas, Texas. So I called her on the phone and I said, hello, is this Rachel? She says, yes. And I said, this is Santa. She says, hi, Santa. And I said, Well, in about 15 minutes, we'll be pulling out. So we're just going over the list one last time to make sure there aren't any errors. I said, we just want to make sure everything's correct. And she says, okay, Santa. And so what I do is I go through the list, but I always fuck up one thing, just, you know, to keep them on their toes. So, I, you know, for example, like, she wanted a Barney doll, so I said Barbie. So I said, and that'll be a Barbie doll? She said, oh, no, no, she says Barney. And I go, oh, Rudolph! I said, Rudolph, that second sack there on the left. I said, make sure, I said, Rachel doesn't want a Barbie doll, she wants a Barney doll. See if we can make a last-minute substitution. And then the kid, you know, totally goes for it. And I yell orders to the elves, to the reindeer. So we do the thing, right? So it's hysterical. But the thing is, I can't laugh, because if I laugh, I blow Santa Claus for the kids, right? So then I say, well, will you be leaving something for Santa and the reindeer to eat? And she says, yes, Santa. And I say, well, will you be leaving this year? She says, oh, some cookies and some milk for Santa. And I said, and what about the reindeer? She said, some carrots and some celery. And I said, well, that's nice. I said, do you think maybe you could leave a tall glass of warm water with 3 tablespoons of sugar dissolved in it? And she says, uh-huh. And I said, you know, you think your mom has a can of sardines? And so she says, you hear, Mom? She says, yeah. So my sister's in the background yelling, yeah. She says, do we have any sardines? And she goes, who are you talking to? She says, Santa. So then you hear this pause in the background. You know, my sister's sitting there processing, you know, what the hell's going on? And she can't laugh. She's got to go with it because it's Santa Claus. So I had my other niece leave cheese. I told them Santa had a hankering for some cheese. I said, and do you think you can ask your mom to cut the cheese this year? So, of course, it goes way over his head. I'm dying. And my little nephew, I told him that I had a hankering for some pickles. I said, do you think you can ask your mom to dice those pickles really small? I said, because we'll be in a hurry, but we won't have time to chew, and I don't want anyone choking on the way out the door. So, of course, these kids don't go to bed until my sisters or brothers go through all of this stuff, right? It was hysterical.
Okay, now, how did you feel?
I felt pretty good.
You made some interesting errors. Do you know what they are?
Hit me.
All right. The first moment, where were they?
Right there.
What is it anchored to?
To the right of the young lady with the red sweater and microphone.
Okay,
or something
to that mic. All right, fine. Now, you didn't establish that reality for you when you started talking.
I jumped right in.
Yeah, you jumped right in without finding the person you want to direct it to. So the first moment was muddy. Do you understand what
yeah.
I mean?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Then you have much too many activities.
Okay.
Now I want you to try it again and find where you stop to tell the story.
Right, okay.
All right? Now, whether you pull the chair around or sit where you are.
Sure, I am right now, maybe, yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
You see, now try it again without further thought and see what happens.
Oh, I had a great time. The best time is when I'm spending time with my nephews and nieces. So for the past 3 years now, every Christmas Eve day, I write down all the kids' names, all my sisters and all their kids and all my friends that have kids. There's so many of them. If I don't write them down, I'm never going to remember them. So at any rate, I write down all their names, and then I call the parents, and I find out what it is that the kids want for Christmas from Santa this year. So that way I'm in the know. And so I call, I get the list, and the day goes on. And I went to Mass this year with my parents in early Mass. We had dinner. Then after dinner, we're having coffee and dessert. And I grab the list, and I grab the phone, and I start calling everybody.
Okay, this is fine, you see? Now we can hear you.
Okay.
Now what's interesting is that you, just where you got up and got the plate, I was going to say, you don't have to stay there.
Right.
So you followed through on an impulse that was absolutely correct. But if the task becomes so primary...
Right, I felt that as I began.
That's what I wondered
especially
if you
especially with the silver, this is too primary, back off. But no, what is so important, what I continue to find strength in, no matter what I'm working on, is that sense of place.
Absolutely.
And the more you know where the hell you are,
absolutely,
you're grounded.
Absolutely.
Then you can add other things. But if you don't have that, there's nothing.
Nothing. Now, this was a very good example, and it worked beautifully, especially the second time through.
Okay?
All right. Very good.
Thank you. different life. The great coward that I am. When a man comes here every day, and every day I know the reason why he comes. Oh, God. I'm stained already. And I should fall on my knees to Sonia and beg her forgiveness. Today you said you were going to show me some maps you were working on. Are you free?
Exhaustion, I forsake my practice and I steal away to spend an hour or two over my maps. Ivan Petrovich and Sophie Alexandrovna are clicking away at the abacus. And I'm seated beside them at my work table, painting away. I'm warm. Everything is quiet and at peace. Crickets outside. Just totally at peace. Once a month, perhaps, not so very often. All right. Okay. Here's our district 50 years ago. Dark and light greens indicate the forests. So as you see, half of the whole is wooded. Now, where we find green crosshatched with red, we have the range of elks, wild goats. We show both the flora and fauna. Now, on the lake, we have swans and geese, ducks. As the old folks say, a power of birds. I mean, as they would say, as far as the eye could see, farther. The cloud of birds just flying. Here's 25 years have passed. Already we see only 1/3 of the area's timber. The goats are gone, the elk, we still see elk occasionally. But the blue and green are vanishing and so on as we go down to the third rendition where we have the district as it is today. There is no solid green, but just the occasional patch. The goats and the swans and the geese have disappeared. The grouse are gone. The game birds, we find no trace of the old settlements. I mean, in short, here is a perfect picture of a gradual and relentless decay, which in 10 or 12 more years will be totally complete and the land will be dead. I mean, you say fine. You say deep cultural influences are at work and the old life must naturally give way to the new. And I would agree with you if in place of decimated forests we had industry and railroads and schools under construction, and mills. And if the populace were happier and in better health and better employment, what do we have here? We have the same swamps and the same mosquitoes, the same typhus and diphtheria and rickets and diseases of poverty. So that what we see is this, a struggle for existence that is beyond human strength. I see that this doesn't interest you.
Well, I understand so little of it.
Ah, apart from that, though, it holds no interest for you.
I must tell you that my mind is on other things.
Oh, I see.
What preoccupied me was... Forgive me. Will you sit down? The matter concerns my stepdaughter, Sonia.
Yes?
How do you feel about her?
I respect her.
And your feelings towards her as a woman?
My feelings toward her as a woman?
Yes.
I have none.
Okay. Now, how did you feel today?
Sometimes I just get so... I want to do it all so much that I lose my grounding. It's like it just all comes up at once. You know, you can't get...
You know what's the matter with you? No, I mean it. Because it's true for many of us. You aren't functioning. As an actress. You're an actress. You're a born actress. You should be on stage all the time. And you're not. And then, the pent up, I'm going to start crying. It's devastating. And then we get a chance and then it isn't complete and it isn't really going the whole way. It's agony. That's why we have to make our own theaters. Right? That's what's torturing you, nothing else but. And if once you know what it is, I mean, then it'll help a little bit. Okay. What can you tell me?
Jeez, I don't know what to say. I'm still having trouble with sort of what I told you before about
the map.
The map.
I didn't. I thought not at the very opening, a little middle section where you lost volition for it.
Yeah.
And then you gained it again, and that will vary too in performance.
It's so frustrated because I try to find something from my life that has such meaning to me that I need to. Express it to somebody.
Why were you crying just now?
No.
That's the meaning.
That started, that's the meaning. I put into this map.
But exactly. Exactly.
I keep feeling like if I bring this feeling from something else into this, I keep wanting to go just with the given circumstances.
But you see, when you find though, when you find your substitution, and then now you truly transfer it to the map, and these become synonymous. That takes a while. What I use for certain things, and this one I can talk about because it's long gone, but something that I used at a certain section, like the trigger moment in Virginia Woolf, I used something, and I don't know why it was me, why it triggered the whole experience in me, was some kind of a piece of ivy crawling up a stucco wall in Ossining, where I once lived. And that leaf, well, eventually, if I think of that leaf now, it comes from Virginia Woolf, not from Ossining anymore. It becomes synonymous. And when you're not accustomed to making transferences and always making sure they have a consequence in the action, that's what anchors them to you. You see, when they stay by themselves and don't get truly transferred, they're very iffy.
Give me an example of the consequence
and
the action.
What is the vine leaf, the emotion that is triggered by the vine leaf, what does that make you do about it? And the doing is to somebody or something on stage. And what is the nature of that action? And if it doesn't lead you to a defined action, it's ephemeral. It hangs there by itself like a little emotional object. So what? Do you see what I mean? And that isn't totally translated yet to that map. It just takes a while. It doesn't come fast when you're not used to doing it. And again, let me remind you, I worked on The Cherry Orchard for about 10 years. I worked on it in English first, then I did it in Russian, then I finally got to do it in a dreary production. The closing performance, I found out how to say goodbye to The Cherry Orchard. The closing night, then I didn't have another chance to do it again, you know? So that's the terrible thing with Chekhov. We can't be impatient in it. We can't score it like a storyline. this I'll play here, and I'll play that there, and I'll play that there. I have to have all the sources. That's why I say 3/4 of Chekhov is homework. And then doing it and doing it and leaving it free and leaving it limber, each time something else will happen. If something is inevitably correct, you'll probably stick to it. But if you stick to it for its effect, it'll be dead. Right? It's an in bottomless hunt for this. So, you see, sometimes you are impatient with yourselves and you want it all to be there at once. It can't be. It's impossible. That I just thought you found out 20 new... Didn't the monologue work better? Now, what about that? That in itself, you've learned a ton.
Really was daunted. I thought I'll never find anything in this room. This is a Victorian drawing room. What's in here? And I found all these things that I might do. That was fascinating.
But you see, the doing is what releases the inner life and releases the images and makes you need to talk. Otherwise you stand and you don't even know where. I mean, the years I stood with monologues and thought, how can I start talking? Not sneaking in. No, not starting that way, but starting. You know? I just thought you made enormous progress. So you should be very excited. Okay? Good.
It's amazing what can happen. You can feel, geez, I can't get this guy. I haven't got him yet. What is it? And then when you get into the costume, something happens. In the picture missing, and I got an idea, and I called up Costa Galvis, and I said, Costa, can I wear a thin-brimmed sort of Brooks Brother hat, just put on straight on my head all through this picture, whenever it's possible? Unless I sit down to dinner, I'd like to have that hat on. And he said, yeah, great, I can see it. What the hat did for me was be a lid. I was aware that I was wearing this hat most of the time, and it helped keep me contained. I don't know why, but it worked for me.
One of the most important things, by the way, in most plays, is underwear. Now, you know, when you say, those Victorians were such prim and proper people, you know, they always sat so straight. Well, they were wearing corsets. And it's very hard if you have stiff, staid corsets coming up and holding you up to do this. You can't. So again, it's not a matter of playing style because that's how they were, but find what it came from. If they say, oh, you shouldn't cross your legs, I say, for the purpose of the exercise, do what they did. They wore 2 petticoats. I defy you to try to cross your legs. Do you see what I mean? Then you won't cross your legs. You will sit because of, not because it's stylistically correct. If your sleeve, instead of being a latex sleeve that bends very easily and it's very tight, and it's so, you'll find that you can't bend your elbow. Do you see? You can only bend it so far. And that if you pour, if you have a beautiful, in an Oscar Wilde play or something, everybody's always, you know, playing style. If you have a long ruche hanging here that it took your housekeeper an half an hour to press properly, you won't want to dunk it in the tea. You will make sure that it's out. If it's good manners not to get a lot of fingerprints on the silver teapot, you will pour in order not to get the fingerprints on. Then you will find the behavior. And of course, I know that nothing has changed in the human psyche except fashion and social mores. But we always got mad. We always fell in love. We always were possessive. We were always slightly neurotic. And all the things that we think are only us today have always been true for the human being. And thought for this exercise to take a character, this is the first time you take a character that you may be going to work on or that you always wanted to work on, and take him or her out of the crisis in which they find themselves in the given play, and give them a simple task, that's something they might do every day, or that they, something I did yesterday or I'm going to do after the crisis is over, so that I start to discover all the sources that make it different than it is now. And to see if I can put my character into a time and place so that I believe I lived there then. That is really the purpose of that exercise.
Thank you.
was divine. Marvelous. We walked into another time and place. From the moment you walked in.
Thank you.
I mean, it was just so right on. It was just superb. Truly. Now, did you have any questions?
Well, I just...
Woo. I can tell you love the character.
I do.
Yeah, I can tell. And now, what is so successful, first of all? The trouble with some of the objects which are difficult is that we run out of inner objects under non-crisis circumstances to keep our attention going while we get dressed. Button buttons, lace shoes. See, that was your bustle. I mean, it was just...
I put it on very tight today. I thought, oh my God, I'm going to...
And then the tightness in relationship to the shoes. No, it was wonderful. What you gain from this exercise and how to work on it, this was an example. You won't see it much better than that. And now if she played this character, 3/4 of the work on the who am I and her faith in historic time and place has been conquered. It's just wonderful. And it never is a costume. You see, that's the dangerous thing. She's not putting on a costume. She's putting on her clothes. She's washing her face, not somebody else's. She is hanging up that particular blouse for tomorrow. I mean, everything. Just wonderful. Every single object you selected in terms of a different time and place and making that habit rather than something strange. Or they did, they would. They would light a lamp like that. They would light their candle like... It was you doing it as though it were your candle, your room, and your habit. It's just wonderful. Literally, not one criticism. Of course, each one of the exercises you can do 10 times or more, which is why people, when they study with me in the beginning, after two or four terms, they're still on the second or third exercise because I don't expect you to race through them. So by the time you get to this exercise, you've been a long time doing the others. When you and once you've exhausted this, then there's a wonderful way of combining them. So you do Charlotta outdoors, right? Charlotta outdoors waiting for somebody. Charlotta having a picnic by herself outdoors. Or any kind of character that gives you trouble in terms of faith. And just combining X's, you can see they all easily combine. Geraldine Page studied with me, God knows, all in all about 6 years, not consistently. And she would come back. And the last few times she came back in the last few years, she only did object exercises. And I said, why? She said, when I did them, I didn't know how valuable they are. She said, it gives me a chance to work on all the staggered conditions. You know, how many, when we put one, we put being in a hurry while I'm hot with a headache and, you know, and I really stagger conditions. That's a very useful exercise. But, no, this was... superb. Okay, very good. Thank you.
If I were younger and you know, the old thing, if you had it to do all over again, not the whole thing to do all over again, but at some point, I would like to have studied the classics more and tried the classics more. I've only done Shakespeare a couple of times in some small parts. I didn't do them very well. And I think it's because I felt a lack of freedom within them. I never felt in control.
Good morrow, Kate. Well, that's your name, I hear.
Well, have you heard? Something hard of hearing. They call me Catherine, but do talk with me.
You lie in faith, for you were called plain Kate. And Bonnie Kate, and sometimes Kate the Cursed. Kate. The prettiest Kate in Christendom. Kate of Kate Hall. My super dainty Kate. For dainties are all Kates. Hearing thy mildness praised in every town, thy virtue spoke of. from the beauty shunned. Yet not so deeply as to thee belongs. Myself am moved and wounded for my wife.
Moved? In good time. Let him that moved you hither remove you hence. I knew you at the first, you were immovable.
Why, what's immovable?
A joint stool.
Thou hast hit it. Come sit on me.
Asses are made to bear, and so are you.
Women are made to bear, and so are you.
No such jade as you, of me, you mean.
Oh, ask a cage. I want a bird for you. For knowing thee to be but young and light.
Too light for such a swain as you to catch. And yet as heavy as my weight should be.
Should be? Should buzz.
Well, Tane, and like a buzzard.
Oh, slow-winged turtle. Shall a buzzard take thee?
Aye. For a turtle, as he takes a buzzard.
Oh, come, come, you wasp and bait, you are too angry.
If I be waspish, must beware my sting.
My remedy is then to pluck it out.
Aye. If the fool could find it where it lies.
Who knows not where a wasp does wear his sting? In his tail.
In his tongue.
Whose tongue?
Yours, if you talk of tails, and so farewell.
What? With my tongue in your tail? Come again, good Kate. I'm a gentleman.
That I'll try.
I swear I will cut you if you strike again.
Only you lose your arms if you strike me. You are no gentleman. And no gentleman, by then no arms.
A herald, Kate. Oh, put me in thy books.
What is your crest? A cock's comb?
A combless cock, so it will be my hand.
No cock of mine. You crow too like a crow.
Hey, come. It looks so sour.
It is my fashion when I see a crab.
Why, there's no crab, and therefore it's not sour.
There is.
Then show it me.
Have it, lots of wood.
What? Do you mean my face?
Well, aim for such a young one.
Now, by St. George, I am too young for you.
I shave you if I tarry. Let me go.
No, not a whit. I am fast and gentle. I was told you were rough and cloy and sullen. And now, I find report a very liar.
How?
Art pleasant, gamesome, passing courteous. But slow in speech. It's sweet as springtime flowers. Thou canst not frown. Thou canst not look askance, nor bite the lip as angry wenches will. Nor hast thou pleasure to be cross in talk. But thou with mildness entertain'st thy wooers. With gentle conference, soft. Why does the world report that Kate doth limp? Oh, slanderous world! That hazel twig is straight and slender. Is brown in hue as hazelnuts? Sweeter than the kernels? Oh, let me see thee walk.
Go, fool, in whom thou keeps command.
Did ever Diane so become a groom as Kate, this chamber with her princely gait? Be thou Diane, let her be Kate, and then let Kate be chaste and Diane sportful.
Where did you study all this goodly speech?
It is extempore from my mother wit.
A witty mother, Willis also son.
Okay, now how did you feel today?
Better.
Oh, yeah. We heard you. You know now what the words mean. They don't always land, but that we're going to talk about. That's the next step. But you really made big progress in the scene. Isn't it funny how then you suddenly understand the scene? It suddenly makes sense if you really talk to each other. Now, how did you feel?
In great part, very good. There were times when I feel like I'm being demonstrative in the scene, and I keep going in my head about not wanting to do that as an actor. Do you know what I mean?
If you do it for her, it's
right.
Correct.
Right.
If you do it for us, it's
right.
Bad acting.
Right.
Do you follow?
Right.
Now, the expectations. You aren't new enough to each other. You already know each other too well. When you send the action, what is the consequence? How did it land? That will lead you to the next. And sometimes you drop in between. Once you've taken the scene apart and understand it this well, don't do homework about receiving it.
Right.
Receive it and go. Do you follow? It will be more tightly linked without rushing it.
Right.
The selection of activities is like day and night now, isn't it? I just thought you learned so many things from this scene that I'm just thrilled. Oh, you should be too.
Thank you.
And you see that we can talk like this.
Right?
Yeah. Right? I have a Shakespeare class. What's interesting is that in the beginning, the idiom is so strange to us, and it's really almost like talking a foreign language. When you get used to it, instead of saying, where are you going? If I say often enough, whither art going, it's as real to me as the other. Do you see? And then we come to the extraordinary things of the fabulous imagery and use of language and ideas that are behind it, which we have to make our own. Okay. No, it was very, very good. Excellent. Okay, I had a ball working with all of you, and I hope I'll come back.